Welcome friends. In this particular video session, I am going to explain few problems based on electrostatics which are been asked in previous JEE and as well as NEET examination. In this question, it is been asked in JEE Advanced 2018. It is mentioned that an infinitely long thin non-conducting wire is parallel to z-axis. It is mentioned this is z-axis, and here is a thin wire whose linear charge density is lambda, carries a uniform line charge density lambda. It pierces a thin non-conducting spherical shell. This is non-conducting spherical shell. This is non-conducting shell, and this is a wire of linear charge density, and this has radius r. The shell has radius r. Non-conducting spherical shell of radius r is in such a way that arc PQ subtends an angle 120 degrees at the center O of the spherical shell as shown in the figure. The permittivity of free space is epsilon naught. Which of the following statements is true? So a thin conducting wire is piercing this spherical shell. That means it make two holes over here for the spherical shell, and through that hole this wire is passing through, which has linear charge density lambda. And this shell, as it is non-conducting spherical shell. This is a non-conducting spherical shell, and here PQ is subtending an angle 120 degrees. Right. Now, as we know, lambda is equal to Q divided by L. Lambda is equal to Q divided by L, and Q inside the shell, you can calculate it as lambda into L, and this length is inside the spherical shell, and that length I need to find out now. If total angle is 120 degrees, this angle will be 60 degrees, and this is 60 degrees. And as you know, it is r. This can be written as r into sine theta, and this is r into sine theta opposite, and the adjacent is r cos theta. So L is length, it is Q inside the conducting shell will be lambda into length of this total, it is 2 times r into sine theta. This is the total length. As this rod has some particular charge, it is having some charge, as it is not mentioned negative, definitely we need to take it as positive charge. As it is positive charge, this positive charge will extend its field outward like this. This is the field of rod extended outward, and this side it will be inward. As it is rod extends, rod, or you can consider it as a wire, it extends its field in outward direction. Now I want to find out what is the total, which of the following statement is true. First, it is that you need to check electric flux, because in the option A and option C, electric flux is mentioned to you. So first check out electric flux passing through this particular shell. So in order to calculate electric flux, I'll be using Gauss law. From Gauss law, we can write pi is equal to Q enclosed divided by epsilon naught. Right, Q enclosed divided by epsilon naught, and this is pi equal to Q enclosed is lambda 2R into sine 60 divided by epsilon naught. This is equal to lambda 2R into sine 60, it is root 3 divided by 2 by epsilon naught. 2 and 2 gets cancelled. This is equal to root 3 r lambda divided by epsilon naught. This is electric flux passing through this conducting shell. How pi is from the Gauss law, pi is being calculated as root 3 r lambda divided by epsilon naught, which is exactly in the option 1. So option A is correct. Now coming to option B, we need to check whether it is correct or not. As z direction is upward, electric field is directed left side and as well as right side. Like if I am considering this as z axis, this as x axis, and this as y axis, along z direction, see, electric field is along x axis, and along z direction it is making an angle 90 degrees, right? Now the z component of electric field is zero at all the points on the surface of the shell. That is option B. However, option C will be wrong because option A is correct. We have already proved it. And you need to check which of the following options are correct, either B or D. And in B, it is mentioned that z component of electric field is zero at all the points on the surface of the shell. Now, if I consider electric field at one particular point on the shell, now let me consider this point. This is electric field. At this point, electric field is outward. At this point, electric field is outward. At this point, electric field is outward. And you can resolve this electric field into components. When I resolve that electric field into components, you will be getting one component along horizontal and another component along the vertical, right? Similarly, here we have electric field vector, and this vector can be resolved into components, and this is vertical and this is horizontal. Clearly from the figure, it is known that this vertical component is positive and this vertical component is negative, because these are the two identical points on the spherical shell. So along z direction, the components, vertical components, gets cancelled over there. So as a result, net field will be only along x axis passing through this particular shell. So therefore, option B is also correct, because the z component of electric field is zero at all the points on the surface of the shell. So option A and option B are correct in this, out of these four given answers. Coming to the next question, it is mentioned here in this problem, it is given a particle of mass 10 power minus 3 kg and charge 1 coulomb is initially at rest. At a time t is equal to 0, the particle comes under the influence of an electric field E, which is given as, and remember, this is electric field which is variable with respect to time, E naught sine omega t, and this is along x axis, and given E naught value is equal to 1.0 Newton per coulomb and omega is equal to 10 power 3 radian per second. Now consider the effect of only the electric force on the particle. What is the maximum speed in meter per second attained by the particle at subsequent times? You are now supposed to find out maximum speed of the particle. So as we know, whenever a charged particle is placed in electric field, charged particle experience force in electric field. As force F is equal to MA, which is equal to Q into E, and this is M dV divided by dt is equal to QE, where E is electric field, and of course this is variable electric field as given in the problem. So you can write dV divided by dt is equal to Q by M into, electric field is given as E naught into sine of omega t, and I am taking only magnitude of this. Of course, electric field as charged particle is positive. Therefore, electric field direction and velocity direction will be same. So velocity will also be in the same I direction, that is x axis. Now I can write dv is equal to q by m into E naught sine omega t into dt. I want to find out velocity, maximum speed in meter per second attained by the particle at subsequent time. So you are supposed to find out maximum speed. So integrating above equation, we can write v is equal to q E naught divided by m into integration sine omega t dt, limits are from 0 to t second. Now in order to find out the time, you need to evaluate the whole integration so that you will be getting final velocity of the charged particle. Substituting omega value, v is equal to q by m sine omega, it is mentioned as 10 power 3 radian per second. And remember that you are supposed to find out maximum speed of the particle. In order to find out maximum speed, whenever, as it has been mentioned, sine function, electric field is maximum at half of the time period, right? So as V is maximum at capital T by 2, time period is equal to 2 pi divided by omega into 2. 2 and 2 gets cancelled. So therefore, V is maximum at T is equal to pi divided by omega, right? Now I'll substitute T here within the limits. V is equal to Q divided by M integration 0 to pi by omega into sine of 1000 T into dt. This is equal to Q by M into cos of 1000 T divided by 1000, and substituting the limits 0 to pi by omega. Now you need to evaluate this total integration and you need to substitute values of the given equations, values of these all, E naught, everything, these values you need to substitute over here so that you will be getting final answer as 2 meter per second. This is the final velocity attained by the charged particle in this uniform electric field. Students, let us solve one more problem based on electric field. And this question is also asked in JEE Advance in paper 2, 2018. And it is mentioned in the problem, an electric field is measured from a point P 0, 0, D generated due to various charge distribution, and the dependence of E on D is found to be different for different charge distributions. List 1 contains different relations between E and D. List 2 describes different electric charge distributions along with their locations. Match the functions in list 1 with the related charge distribution in list 2. So here we have different, in the list 2 we have different materials which are being continuous charge distributions. You need to write down electric field equations first to those points, to those distributions. See, first one, in the list 2, first is given a point charge Q at the origin. So when you are placing a point charge Q at the origin, electric field will be given by E is equal to KQ divided by D square, because the separation, it is mentioned as 0, 0, D, separation is D square, that is for point charge. So for a point charge, electric field is inversely proportional to D square. That is the reason why E is inversely proportional to D square is matched with equation, matched with the first material in list 2. Next, coming to the second one. A small dipole with point charge Q at 0, 0, L and minus Q at 0, 0, -L take 2L separation less than D. So dipole, for a dipole moment, we can find out electric field on the equatorial line as, for a dipole, it is E is equal to KP divided by D cube, and this is on the equatorial line. So it is mentioned 0, 0, L and 0, 0, minus L. So dipole is situated along Z axis. And you are finding electric field at point D, which is along Z axis. So for a dipole, E is equal to KP by D cube. This is on the equatorial point. So electric field E is inversely proportional to cube of the separation between those two points. So E is proportional to D cube. This matches with 2. Now coming to next, an infinite wire, electric field E, so infinite line charge coincident with X axis with uniform charge density lambda. So for an infinite wire, it is electric field E, which is being derived as 2K lambda divided by D. So electric field is inversely proportional to D. So E is inversely proportional to D. That is for number 3. Next, for an infinite plane sheet, for an infinite plane sheet, E is equal to sigma by 2 epsilon naught. What is sigma? Sigma is equal to Q divided by length L into 2 epsilon naught. It is independent of D. So for infinite sheet, for infinite plane charge coincidental with XY plane with uniform charge density, for infinite plane sheet, E, electric field is independent of D. So that is the reason why fifth one matches with P. Fifth one is matching with this P. Now coming to the fourth one. Two infinite wires carrying uniform linear charge density parallel to x-axis. So from here, you have infinite wire which is extended along these two axes, along x-axis. The one along y is equal to 0 to z is equal to L has a charge density of plus lambda, and the one along y is equal to 0 to z is equal to minus L has a charge density minus lambda. Now taking 2L is less than D. That means the length of these two materials, it is very much less than D as it is mentioned. Okay. Now you are taking this as one conductor, two sheets, and one is starting from Y is equal to 0. It is passing towards Z is equal to L. And the other one is passing towards Z is equal to minus L. And it is mentioned charge density as plus lambda and as well as minus lambda. You are now supposed to find out electric field over here. Now this is the point where you want to find out electric field. Now because of positive rod, electric field is distributed outward. Because of the negative rod, electric field is distributed towards it. Now these two can be resolved into components. So this vector, if I resolve, you'll be getting one component here. And this vector, if you resolve, you'll be getting one component over here. And vertical components, one is positive and the other one is negative, these gets cancelled. Only horizontal components will be left over. And that horizontal component electric field is given by E is equal to 2k lambda r divided by into cos alpha. Sorry. Now what is cos alpha? Alpha is the angle between two charges. So this angle is alpha. If this is angle alpha, then obviously this is alpha. How do you write cos alpha? Cos alpha is equal to this length, it is L divided by separation. This is D square plus L square under root. Under root D square plus L square. This is cos alpha. And however, R is over here. That R is under root D square plus L square. So taking that over here, under root of D square plus L square and under root of D square plus L square, it will become D square plus L square. So finally, you will be getting E is equal to 2K lambda L divided by D square plus L square. This is with 4. This is for 4. Now these are 5 in the list 2. We have 5 different materials. And in the list 1, we have dependence of electric field with D. Now you need to check these options. P is E is independent of D, that is matching with 5, and Q, it is matching with 3, and third one R, it is matching with 1. So 5, 3, and 1, and next last S is matching with 2. S is matching with 2. So option 1 is correct. This is how you can write up. So as when I am teaching you, I already told you, you need to remember all these equations for electric field and electric potential. If you remember them, you can directly write down the equations for all those electric fields, for a point charge, for a dipole, for infinite wire, for infinite plane sheet. But this fourth one, you need to derive it. So using these equations, directly you can write down the dependence of electric field with D, and you can match those from list 1 to list 2. Students, coming to the next question. This question has been asked in JEE Mains 2018. There are 3 concentric shells, and first shell has charge density plus sigma and radius A. Second shell has charge density minus sigma with radius B. Third shell has plus sigma charge density and its radius is C. Now each material is having its own charge. So as we know, sigma is equal to Q divided by A. A is area of cross section. So it is Q divided by area is 4 pi r square, that is surface area of the spherical shell. And this is spherical shell, it is not a circle, it is shell. That is the reason why surface area of the shell is 4 pi r square. Now in order to find out charge on any surface, you will be using this relation, sigma 4 pi r square. Take this as equation number 1. Now I want to find out electric potential on the shell P. I want to find out electric potential on this shell B. And shell B is outside shell A, and shell B is inside shell C. Right? Let me take this as A, this as B, and this as C. Therefore, potential on B will be due to charge on shells A, comma B, and C. So because potential is a scalar quantity, you need to add all the potentials. Potential due to A will be there here, potential due to B will be there here, and potential due to C also will be there here. Now let me consider charge upon this surface is QA, charge upon this surface is QB, charge upon this surface is QC. As we know, equation for electric potential due to spherical shell, electric potential due to shell V is equal to K Q divided by R. Right? Now I want to find out potential on B. V B is equal to B is outside the B is out of shell A. Shell A has charge plus sigma. Therefore, here you can write it as K. Charge upon shell A is QA divided by separation of the point where you are finding electric potential is outside shell A. That is the reason why you need to take radius B over here. That is radius B. And remember, it is positive charge, so it will be plus. Next, coming to shell B, you are finding electric potential due to this shell B, and that is minus K charge on B divided by, it is exactly on the surface. That is the reason why you will be writing B as it is, the radius of the second shell. Now coming to the third one, it is K Q, which is charge on the third one. As third one, third shell is outside the point where you are calculating electric potential. So therefore, you need to take the separation from the center to the charge where it is situated. So charge is situated at a distance C. That is the reason why you will be taking distance C. Even though you are finding potential at point B, you need to take the distance between the center and the separation where the charge is situated on the surface when you are dealing with potentials. Now finally, you can write VB is equal to K into QA by B minus qb by b plus qc divided by c. Let me take this as equation number 2. Now you can write down qa, qb, qc values. qa is equal to sigma 4 pi a square, qb is equal to sigma 4 pi b square, qc is equal to sigma 4 pi c square. Now substituting all these values over here, you can write k is equal to qa, qb, qc, all those have common sigma 4 pi. So I will be taking sigma 4 pi out. And what is left over here? qa. qa is a square by b minus qb, it is b square by b, so only b is left over there, plus qc is c square by c, only c is left over here. This is the final expression of the potential in the shell B. On the surface of shell B, the potential is given by a square k sigma 4 pi into a square by b minus b plus c. You can select options from these four options. Obviously, second one is giving you correct answer, sigma by epsilon naught. Because k I am writing it as k, you can write it as 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. So this, that gives you finally sigma by epsilon naught into, take LCM of this, b, a square minus b square divided by b plus c. This gives you option B. Option B is correct answer for this.